Alright, so we're talking about EMS control.
What?
Yep.
So developing a different light. Basically, what this presentation is going to be, a whole lot of you talking about EMS controls, why purpose of them, history of it, and then we'll have some demo time, some fun, and then we'll have some questions answered. I try not to read from the board, but I am using it as a guideline. So, who am I? My name is Justin. I currently own a local entertainment company doing weddings and production work. I also work in the IT sector. Been working in theater and performance for a long time, since 94. I'm at the Stagehand Union, Penn State, Courthouse, Carousel Amphitheater, Carousel Dinner Theater, Time Warner Amphitheater, some of the above. Shows at Vincent Lighting Institute, a production company specializing in lighting. The whole thing we're going to talk about is the basic DMX 512, including the history, theory of operation, proper equipment use, and some of the limitations of it. We'll talk a little bit about some of the expansions, the things that are coming down the pipeline for us. Kind of interesting. DMX is basically a set of rules and protocol. It's used for remote control of lighting fixtures, and it's one of the really, really nice things about it. It's an independent standard. It's manufacturing specific, so we can use on pretty much a lot of the modern devices, almost everything except it. Wasn't the way of the past. The history of it started with large, previous to that, theaters, production suites would be outside, so you need light. And when they're outside, they're subject to the sun. And when the stage was pointed, it was dependent upon which way the sun was facing. So they want to have it in the afternoon, they also want to be cool, so we need to be facing that particular direction. Obviously, that leaves very little control for dimming and adjustment. That's why the globe theater has a giant open ceiling. And it's completely right around, so you can get that open space. And they would actually stage throughout the globe. Look theater, they would actually, that's where Shakespeare plays are done. They would actually stage it and arrange it so different chords today, so it's getting a dimmer, and correspond to different points in part of the play. Fast forwarding to the modern age of electronics, we've gotten past gas, and the cool things, hot things today are resistive dimmings. They utilize huge banks of arms and controllers. These are larger than this wall, and you would come up to each one and you pull down and it would independently control one particular dimmer. And one dimmer is connected to a particular circuit that would control a bank of lights. So this may bring on these three lights, these six lights here, my dimmers might bring on the apron, the front of the stage. These ones back here might handle the back of the stage. Resistive dimming is obviously pretty inefficient. You waste a lot of energy in heat, and so they said, crap, we need to come up with a better solution. And, during that resistant period, they also used salt water, because the building really could be dynamic and change. Again, very messy, wasting electric plates. The next cool thing on the block was actually an auto transformers, which is sometimes called variacs. I have one of them right here. They'll use a single winding for their transformer, and instead of having two, a primary and a secondary, everything is connected to a primary, and where you tap that off will determine the amount of voltage that you receive from the output. The next thing, which is very cool, came around when we had silicon control rectifiers, and that's phase dimming. And the way that that operates is we've got a normal sine wave that comes around, it's a regular signal. And at a particular point, we will turn it on, and then we will cut it off. And this is forward-based rectification, and this is rear, reverse. Both of them, this is a little easier to produce than that one, because the timing can be a little less than the one over in reverse. But reverse is better for devices that need to have high-intensity ballast, or are not able to be sustained by the choke that's built into the design. So this is the common manufacturing equipment today. And that's the same technology that exists in some of these zipper packs that I've got here. So we've gone from huge beast that only handles one particular channel to one of these that handles four. And they're going even smaller and more efficient, and they waste hardly any energy. The issue with these designs, though, is that you can't control electronic devices. You can't control instruments that, or fixers that might need to have a more granularity. So fluorescents and other especially high pressure devices have issues with that. Ed? Why is DMX awesome? I think it's pretty awesome. The reason for our talk is that, like I said, manufacturing agnostic. It's a rugged design and roadworthy, and it's also simple to deploy. It does not require a whole lot in cabling. It doesn't require a whole bunch in knowledge or understanding how the networks are put together, like you might expect from Ethernet standards or something like that. We need to know a lot of subnetting. It just pretty much works. Some of the things that you want to know, which I say that there are no limits, but there's 512 DMX 5 codes, how many attachments, 5 codes attached. The name, and that is 512 channels. So a channel is a particular type of instruction, value at a particular point. And if you want to go beyond 512, you need to separate out into universes. And universes are completely independent spaces. So you'll have universe 1, universe 2, universe 3, or universe A, B, and C. Some of the other cool things is that it requires up to 500 meters in length. So that's much longer than an Ethernet line. That's daisy chain. Connection. Its cable impedance is around 110 to 120. At the end of a chain, you're supposed to, part of the standard is that you're required to put a 110 to 120 volt, 25 watt resistor on the data lines. And the reason you do that is to prevent reflection. Short lines, you don't really worry about that. And like I said, it's a daisy chain environment. DMX is actually pretty darn old. It is 26 years old. It came out in 1986, developed by the United States Institute of Theater Technology. And in 1988, it was transferred to the Entertainment Services and Technology Association. It was approved by ANSI in November 2004, revised since then in 2008. Really, it's been almost the same since its inception. The design really has not changed too much. It's actually from RS. 485, a previous standard, has some of the similar designs to it. The newest provision only really changes some of the grounding designs in it, or groundings in the Sigma. But pretty much since then, you can take the device from the early 90s and pull it out, sit it down, plug it into the rest of the line, it's going to work. It's pretty rock solid in that nature. Somebody had mentioned that it's a thought that it's related to MIDI, and it very much is similar to it. It uses it's came from the same type of mindset at the same time. Use of five pins are a part of the standard, only three of them are in use. It is defined as a synchronous serial digital data protocol. It sounds like a bunch of word vomit, but if we break it down, it actually makes a lot more sense. So if you start at the other end rather than this end, protocol being rule. Data, information, digital. Pretty much the first two are kind of simple. Digital, what does that really mean? It means for binaries, zeros or ones, no real difference. Zero being no voltage, one being a positive voltage. They have 8 bits per byte, and 0 to 255 for 8 bytes. Probably you guys all know that information. There's two types of coming down to serial. There's two types of serial communications. There's synchronous, and so you've got a synchronous bit stream that'll be coming out. What that basically means is that both ends, the sender and the receiver, will both have precise timings. The timing is set by their internal clocks, and they need to be precise and stay within certain tolerances. Very expensive, difficult to maintain, difficult to bring online. Asynchronous, awesome thing about that is part of the bytes, part of the signal that's coming to you includes frame sets and timings that are included in that. So timing still need to be clean, can still be close, because they need to interpret that particular timing, maintain that between the next timing section, but because because you have a very close tolerance, you have about 5% tolerance, and that's perfectly fine. While if you were in synchronous mode, you need to be much closer than that. So it's simple and cheap. One of the designs and one of the requirements for DMX. So the two serial standards being balanced and unbalanced, sealed in a differential. The DMX 512 uses a differential design. Basically, it sends both a signal in a positive and also in a negative design. So if we've got a particular impulse on like a data plus and data minus, signal's going to come in, and when it pops up going high, this one's going to go low at the exact same time. And the reason for that is because as they apply the signal along, and if this particular, during this cable, when they've got a ground reference, if a voltage is applied, such as by heavy fan, or you've got a design, you're coming by a motor, or you're going by a truck, or an air conditioner where it's got a lot of RF signal to it, it's going to enact a voltage in these. So if you didn't have one of these lines, you apply this voltage, raising it up, you might not know the ground reference. You wouldn't know, okay, was this supposed to be here, or was it supposed to be here, or where is it supposed to be? You start getting misunderstanding. But if you've got the same difference here, you now have got a reference that you can correspond for us, and you can mathematically remove that signal and bring it back to the original plan. So there's three cables that are used in DMX. Five are part of the standard, which is really odd, but I'll come to that in a second. There are a console is the basic device that starts the whole signal. There's 512 channels in the universe, and no more than 32 devices are supposed to be added onto a bus, being a particular universe chain. But you can create opto isolators and repeaters to extend the signal and split the bus. So you can take a controller, like I have right here, introduce a repeater or a splitter, and then create two different bus lines. And those can extend the number of devices you have on a particular bus. The next thing is what the cable is actually designed for. Somebody mentioned that they do they use audio cables. And they do use a very similar to audio cable. They use a cable connection called an XLR, which is called the Canon X connector with latch and rubber guard. It's a mouthful. It's designed for five pins. Three pins have been standardized for use. The other two were designed for reverse communications or secondary future purposes. It's been theorized. Some developers and manufacturers have actually used it to split two different universes on one particular cable. Similar to what you use in the Ethernet standard, where you've got a couple of pairs of wires that are not being used. The issue, though, with using a cable and using a 3-pin, a 5-pin is actually designed, is if you apply the 5-pin and put it into, say, a mixer that offers a 48 volts of phase power for like a charge capacitance microphone, you would damage the devices on the other end. So that's not good. So you gotta keep those two things separate, along with that there are different cable standards. So microphone cable being around 75 ohms is different than DMX cable. So again, you've got 5 pins, the standard, with pin 1, 2, and 3, so that should be 3, not a 2. As the three different shield data, data positive, and then again, same over here, so all the numbers matches up. DMX 512 does 250 kilohertz max speed, which basically comes to bits measuring 4 microseconds per interval, so bit takes that long with an idle signal as being high. So the positive signal will be high, the data signal will be low. Respective, so that they're completely mirrored. 6 volts is difference, and like I said, it's designed on the RS-485 standard. The packet chain and train is designed, again, we're going to go into some fine point here, with this particular mind. You've got the brake, the mark after brake, a start code, a mark time between frames, the actual channel data, and the mark time between packets with each one of them. So the brake obviously resets the line. It heads to low. It does it for about a second to 1 second. It's 285 to 250 millimeters per second. The mark after the brake basically gets the system ready. It says, are you ready to go? Let's go ahead and bring the system online. The start code is the exact same, and that determines how long, tells the receiver how long a particular channel value is going to be. It's used for timing. So you got SC start code, the same size as the channel data. It's mixed, dependent on the same as the channel data, and it is 11 bits, 44 microseconds. The mark time between frames spaces out the individual data byte, bytes. It's always set as high. 0 to 250 or 0 to 1 second. The channel data goes to individual channels. So channel 1, channel 2, channel 3, channel 4, channel 5, all the way up to 512. It carries the 8-bit DMX value plus 1 start bit and 2 stop bits. The start and stop bit obviously sandwich and bookend the particular channel data. The 11 megabits, 44 microseconds, the mark between packets that separates. So if you think about a train in a car, you've got the lead engine that's going to pull the system along, and that's going to be the brake, mark after brake, the mark time between frames, and then starting up from there. And each one of the cars are connected by the mark time between frames, and then the car is the channel data. Channel data actually maintains that particular set. And then the last is the boost is the mark between packets. And that basically tells the whole signal, the whole chain, that we're finished. Hold for the particular signals that you have right now. Wait for the next beginning break. And space out the entire DMX packet. And that's high between 250 kilobytes per second, 0 to 1 second. Both, you may see that a lot of these have a lot of variability in their timing, especially between the marks, the breaks, and mark time between frames. The reason for that is that when the original design was coming out, they needed the processors that were in the operating were very weak, and they could not maintain enough signal transfer and keep the frequency up fast enough. So they spaced it out, gave plenty of information, plenty of room, and they used something called a higher takes precedence, where if a signal is lost or miscommunicated or lost from the point, it'll be dimmer or device to maintain that same signal until a new proper frame packet comes by, which of course comes out in 44 seconds. 44 times a second. Fully loaded, the DMX is 5,700 bits, 44 packets per second. There's no error provision, so you can see there's like no CRC checks, no MD5s, nothing fancy about it. And that's why the DMX standard is prohibited from life safety applications. So you can't use it for rigging, you can't use it for pyrotechnics, you can't use it for moving stages or closing motors and things like that. All of this is, the lights come on, you happen to mess up, but because there's no protection in the device design, you can't likely trust that. Multiple nodes, node being a particular endpoint, can be on the same address, and nodes can use multiple addresses. So if I'm going to some of these fixtures, these lights are called fixtures, DMX, different packs called dimmers. If I'm going to each one of them, they usually have a start number, and the start number, and they will use a multitude of channels. So this DMX mixer has four channels in it. And if I'm going to choose one, it's going to use 1, 2, 3, 4. If I started at 4, it's going to go 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. If I did 5, it'd be 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. The starting number sets the span of the node's range, so where it's going to begin at. You can have multiple notes, like I said, being on the exact same point. So you could have all of the instruments and devices all starting at channel 1. They're all starting at channel 1, they're all going to use all the same instruction set, they're probably all the same tiers, using value between 0 and 255. Note addressing, and the old school is binary, then we came to pushpin, and the newest stuff is DMX. We'll bring you a little screen that you can choose a particular address on. Pretty simple for DMXing. You've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, possibly 10, but really 1 through 9 determine your particular value. 1 being 1, 2 being 2, 3 being 4, 4 being 8, 5 being 16, 6 being 32, 64, 128, 256. The last one, in order to achieve a 512, you turn them all off, and that would actually determine that it's at 255 rather than being 0, because 0 does not exist. There's sometimes, like I said, there's a 10th channel, a 10th switch on there, like one of my instruments over here, which we can look at on later, and that will determine whether or not it actually recognizes DMX, or if it does its auto mode without having a cable plugged in. So a lot of these will do their own thing and just be given a free will. This one over here, you can see that it uses a little pushpin selectors. Right now it's on 1, but you can push that up and down until you get the particular one you want. 1990, there's the standard date, DMX 512 1990. And then this particular one uses a 5-pin. Most of the ones I have here are 3-pin, but I do a couple of 5-pin. And then, of course, the DMX, it just pushes up and down. The number you start from, like I said, that's the starting point. If you want more than 8 bits of resolution, such as some of the movers and devices that I have here, they want to have more granular control. 255 degrees of movement is not enough. It's going to be far too separating expression from all their throws. So, what they do is they will actually use a fine and coarse control. When you add those two together, you get 16 bits, and now you get 65,536 steps. A lot more granular control, pan and steps, whatever that's where it's used. The next thing from there, the on-DMX simple limitations are the fact that, of course, it does not have Zoom one-way communication. What if I wanted to know how long the device has been operating for? I want to know if a particular device needs to have its lamp replaced, or if it's stuck, or if I can't control it, or if I wanted to go and change that device's address while it's on the ceiling. I don't want to go get a ladder and go climb up there and go fix it unless I know what's actually wrong. The remote, the device management is the thing that operates that. That is a new standard that came out. It's actually been ratified and ready to go. And that uses the same DMX cabling, same DMX design, but fits in between the packets. So between the breaks, mark after breaks, it can send signals back and return. When you do use an RDM device, RDM system, all of the splitters, not the isolators, repeaters, all have to be bidirectional.